Hack Obadiah.
Yes, sir.
In the call, hold on a second, hold on. Would you like to start us off, Ak, with a reading of Psalms chapter 40?
Yes.
Thank you.
I waited patiently for Yahuwah, and he inclined unto me, and he heard my cry. He brought me up also out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon the rock, a rock, and established my goings. And he has put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto Elohim. Many shall see it and fear, and shall trust in the Almighty.
Hallelujah. One second. Forty and two. He brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of miry clay. For those of you who may or may not know, in the book of Daniel, where it talks about the prophecies of the nations and like the ascension of different nations in antique and coming that would be history to us, but future to them. He showed him the statue of the man, and the head was gold, and the breastplate was silver. The head represented Babylon, and the breastplate represented Persia. And then, what was the loins were, was it iron? And then the legs were, or the breast or the loins might have been brass, and then the legs were iron, and the feet was a mix of like mud and iron, or miry clay and iron. And as I read that, as it, just like we were just talking about Daniel, he brought me up out of, also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet up on a rock. That's what we're waiting on, to be brought up from up under this. And the iron, and mixed with the iron, mixed with the feet, were a representation of Rome. And then it said that the rock was carved out of a rock carved without hands came, and it crushed the statue. And that verse there just reminds me of, like we were just talking, Aki, being ready to be brought out of this miry clay mixed with iron, seeing that based off the prophecies and the way things look, it seems that this is the season. Verse 4.
Blessed is that man that maketh the Almighty Yah his trust, and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies.
Ain't no respect of the proud. The word for proud, rahab, insolent. And you know what? I looked this word insolent up, and it said, I thought it was interesting. It says showing a rude and arrogant lack of respect. There is a way to get a point across without being rude or arrogant. There is a way to rebuke somebody if they're truly wrong without being rude and arrogant. We have to be careful. We know we live in a proud world. Everybody's proud. Everybody's proud of you. But I'm just making fun of that. But with that being said, in what we call the truth, though, it's even more so important to be mindful of this, because I've seen, and I'm sure some of you have seen, where we may even be right in something, but our approach can come off really proud, prideful. And we see that Yah says he respects not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Hallelujah. Keep going.
Blessed is that man. Okay, many.
You could read verse 4 again. You can read it.
Blessed is that man that maketh the Almighty Yah his trust, and respected not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Many, O Yah, my Elohim, are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to us toward, they cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare that I speak of them, they are more than can be numbered.
Aki, that's why we just give thanks, because the wonderful works of Yah, the things that He's done to our lives, they can't even be reckoned up in order. The Father has done things for us we can't even recollect. The Father has closed doors for us that we didn't even know were about to open, that was going to lead us down a path that we didn't want to be on. And this is why we give thanks, because the wonderful works of Yah can't be reckoned in order, they cannot be numbered. Verse 6.
Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened, burnt offerings and sin offerings hast thou not required.
Even when I was wrong, God, you opened my ears. And I didn't even have to sacrifice and offer anything as far as an animal or the grain or whatnot, the offering of the produce. I don't know, I'm using the wrong word, but it was offerings of that, a wine offering. I didn't have to do any of the offerings that we see that they do in the Bible, because you never desired the offering. From the beginning of time, it's always been about obedience. Adam, all you asked him was to be obedient. The offering is something you allowed as we repent, put our best forward of the things that we had as a sign to show that we were going to change from whatever way we had and put our best forward in our life to not do XYZ again. But the sacrifice and the offering was never nothing that the Most High desired. It was always a desire for us to be obedient to the things that He was doing and saying and trying to show us. Verse 7.
Then said I, lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me.
The volume of the book, Hamashiach, can be found.
I delight.
Forgive me. We read on Tuesday on the road to Emmaus, when after he had risen and the disciples wasn't sure who he was, and the man was walking with them to Emmaus, and they were like, man, we hear he around and this and that. And he was like, you fools, y'all know he around. Didn't the book say, and didn't he say, and prophecy say? And it said, when they realized who he was, I can't think of the exact wording, but paraphrasing that scripture, it said that he showed them everywhere in the book, in the scriptures, starting at Moses, it said. So mind you, he's talking Old Testament, because at that time they were living the New Testament or the Gospels. They hadn't been written yet. And he showed them everywhere, starting from Moses and the prophets, the Kings, the Chronicles, books that we don't even have, where he could be found. And they got a real-time representation of him being found in the volume of the book. Verse 8.
I delight to do thy will, O my Elohim. Yea, the law is within my heart.
The law is within my heart. That's how we have to be. The awakening is not about who has all the knowledge, who knows all the scriptures, who has all the revelations. Those are things that come with it, with studying to show ourselves approved, no doubt. But as he said about the sacrifice, the first and foremost thing about what the Most High is trying to show us and do is to be obedient and to carry his word in our heart. If you carry his word in your heart, your heart is where your will comes from. It's where your mind is at. It's where it is the center of a man, the definition says. And we're going to define that word in a few minutes. If you carry his word there, then it'll guide your steps And that is the first thing, as we call to be followers and believers of the Bible, the first thing we need to do is commit to obedience and carrying the word of Yah in our hearts, making it the center of all things that we do. Verse 9.
Hallelujah. I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips, O Heavenly Father, though thou knowest.
Yeah.
I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared my faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy loving kindness and thy truth from the great congregation.
The Most High has woken us up to truth. We need to make sure that we spread this word to the great congregation. And in this case, he's talking about Israel. Yah didn't make the covenant with one man. Now, granted, he made it with Abraham, but he said the covenant will be upon your seed. When he made it with Jacob, he said the covenant will be on your 12 sons and their descendants. The covenant was not made with one man. Truth is not restricted to one person. Truth is not restricted to one group. You got, even in this awakening, it's just like the very thing that we despise, the church. You have what looks like, what is the word? Denominations, different churches. This church don't mess with that church. We believe in this doctrine. It's slightly different from your doctrine. We can't coincide. The truth was not given to one camp, one organization, one coalition, one group. It was not given to one man. It was not to be concealed. The truth, the word of Yah's mercy, his forgiveness, is to be spread to all those who want to hear and anybody who's willing to hear. Now, you got some people, I know some people who I grew up with, I've been really close to. They have let me know over time, they don't want to hear anything about that. They made a decision. So the truth ain't for them because they've openly said they don't want to hear anything about that. But anybody, whether it be Israelite or Gentile, whether he be a European Gentile, a Hamitic African Gentile, a Arabic Gentile, an Asian Gentile, and any other thing you could think of, if he's willing to hear the truth, then it is our job not to conceal it from anybody. And you see that in this awakening too. Some people feeling like this is beyond other people, so I'm not even going to tell them anything. That's not what has been called. That's not what we've been called to be. Verse 11.
Withhold not thy tender mercies from me, O Lord, O Heavenly Father. Let thy loving kindness and thy true truth continually preserve me. For innumerable evils have compassed me about mine iniquities. Have taken hold upon me, so that I am not able to look up. They are more than hairs on my head. Therefore, my heart faileth me. Be pleased, O Heavenly Father, to deliver me, O Yah. Make haste to help me. Help them be ashamed and confounded together that seek after my soul to destroy it. Let them be driven backward and put to shame that wish me evil.
Israelite or Gentile. Verse 15.
Let them be desolate for a reward of their shame that say unto me, Aha. Let all those that seek thee rejoice and be glad in thee. Let such as love thy salvation say continuously, the Heavenly Father be magnified. But I am poor and needy, yet the Almighty think it upon me. Thou art my help and my deliverer. Make no tarrying, O my Elohim.
Don't wait. Don't make haste, Abba Yah. We are poor and needy. We are the tail and not the head, as scriptures say. We are last and never the first. We work the hardest and never move up. We make the least in the company. We never get the promotion. We are overqualified and we always lose the position to somebody that isn't as qualified. We are overqualified, but we never get accepted into the school over somebody who's underqualified. We have to bear the most, yet we know that you are our help and our deliverer. And we just pray that you don't tarry, that you don't wait, that you see what we're going through and you act. And Yah, as we know, you will, whenever you do act, because we know that you will, it's always in perfect time. Hallelujah. Thank you for the read, Ab.
Hallelujah. Praise Yah.
We read that as we go into prayer. And Shabbat Shalom to all of you who've come in as he was reading. As we go into prayer, Abba Yah, as always, we humble ourselves and we thank you, Father, for blessing us to see another day, for allowing us to see another Shabbat, for making us healthy and whole, for giving us sound minds, no matter what age we are, and for revealing yourself to us to be our deliverer, our strength, our protector, the father of our kinsman redeemer, the holy one of Yasharoah. As we go into today's reading, Abba Yah, just ask that you increase as I decrease, that you put the words into my mouth, and anybody who makes comments or has anything to add to the conversation, that you guide us all with your Ruach HaKodesh, which is to reveal all things, but that we speak a profitable word, not just for the people here, but for anybody who may hear. Anybody who may come across this reading. Hallelujah. We pray for all of the children, all of the people on the call with children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. That you bless our children. As the Torah says, you will bless the fruit of our womb, our wife's womb, and that you guide our children all their days from this day. Some of us has just now come into the understanding of who we are and who you are in relationship to our ancestors and the responsibility that comes with such a calling. And we pray that from this day, you let that seed be planted, watered, and increased by you as only it can. Father, we pray that you use us as servants to be a help, an inspiration, an encouragement to whomever you choose for us to stand in front of. We ask, Abba Yah, that you show us where we are wrong when it comes to the way we feel this should go or the way we see this going, Abba Yah, for only you know how this is going to look. Only you know the magnitude, as Torah tells us, the second Exodus will be the biggest ever. It will be one of the greatest things to ever behold. And we just ask, Abba Yah, that you put us in the right space, the right time, the right season, the right mind, for only you can. I pray for everybody on the call, Abba Yah, that they have a blessed Shabbat, a peaceful Shabbat, that anybody who may be ailing from anything, that you let your healing be upon them like the dew up on the grass, or as I look out my window, like the snow up on everything right now. That you continue to cleanse us, Abba Yah, as the mighty Elohim that you are, the forgiving Elohim that you are, the merciful Elohim that you are. That you forgive us of our sins, that you continue to have mercy on our households, and that you let your word go forth in a respectful and compassionate way, and in a way to inspire all those searching for you. In the name of Yahushua HaMashiach, we pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Isaiah. What is this thing? Isaiah chapter. We stopped at 49 last time, right? Yeah. And I will feed them that oppress thee with their own flesh, and they shall be drunken with their own blood. Those who oppressed you, in the end, they're gonna eat their own. It's a bold statement, y'all. They're gonna be drunken with their own blood. They've been drunken with yours. Mystery Babylon, she's been drunk with the blood of the saints. And now that Yah done woke us up and gave us understanding of what he was saying, we know that the blood of the saints mean they've been drunken with the blood of Israel. That's actually a really bad word, the way it's interpreted from scripture, the word saints. Because based off the letter of the scriptures, there really is no such thing as a saint. Like, what is a saint? Somebody that's perfect in righteousness? Somebody that's perfect with Yah? I shouldn't say it ain't no such thing, but it's few and far between, you know? Just because we, even us, just because we get up on the Shabbat and we do this does not make us saints. Now, I believe some of you may be saints, but it's more to make you a saint that the things and the way that you carry yourself, the way that you go about your life than just being a saint. But in Revelation, when he uses saint, he's talking about the children of Israel. Because who has Mystery Babylon been drunk with their blood? You go back to actual Babylon, it was about Israel. The Persians come through in freedom. The Greeks come through with who they call Alexander the Great. They teach us about him in school. Think about that. You learn about Alexander the Great in high school. I learned about him in simple history in high school. In high school, we were never told that he conquered down into what you would call Israel, down all the way into Egypt and Africa from Europe. I never was aware of that. I just knew that they called him Alexander the Great, and he was supposedly this great general. I remember that old movie they had with him. They in the movie, if I'm not mistaken, because I haven't seen it in years, they never said that he was in Africa. I just remember them showing him saying that he had caught some disease in the dark lands, they were saying, in a place where the people was dark. And naturally, in the movie, all of the so-called dark lands was half of white boys. Hey, they was calling it the dark land. But who were the Greeks drunk with? When you read the Maccabees, when you read all of these other stories that's from that time, right? Who blood were the Greeks drunk with? It was Israel. It was us, the descendants of Israel. This world has always been drunk with the blood of Israel. The Romans in the time of Hamashiach. Mind you, because the Greeks and the Romans were, all of those nations were in control of all of the known world. All of what was the known world to them, because that don't mean it was everybody in the world. But in the known world and of in the annals of history, all of those other nations that they were under were okay with submitting to what they were doing. They were okay with taking on their laws, taking on their gods, taking on their ways, doing what they were doing. And it was always be when you read scripture, those nations will be talking to the heads of the governing states, because it would be broken up into governing states. Like Pilate was the head of a governing state. He wasn't Caesar. But all those nations around would talk to the heads of the governing states and be like, you better watch these Israelites. The book of Esther is like that. Nehemiah is like that. And Ezra, when they were back building the temple, you had the Edomites and the people that were still in the land. Think when the Babylonians come through, they didn't snatch up all of the Edomites and the Philistines and the Girgashites and the Perizzites and the Hezzites and all of these other tites and ites that were in the land. No, it said that they made Israel leave. Because this world has always been drunk with the blood of the saints. You get down into the time of Hamashiach. You don't have any other stories in history about them hanging a man in a tree for nothing. No, it was Hamashiach, an Israelite. Other Israelites. You don't hear about them burning down Nineveh and Samaria, which were places that were around at that time, even Egypt. You know, you got this thing with Egypt and the pyramids is up. Some people will tell you Egypt is the height of life today, right? They did burn down that Alexandria Museum, but I personally, and it's just my opinion, but I think Yah had that museum burnt down because I believe the first Septuagint was there. And I really believe that Yah felt like as Israel was leaving, y'all don't deserve to have my word. And that's why that Alexandria library that you always hear about that had all of this so-called knowledge in it, which it probably did, because the Romans at that time, it was either the Greeks or the Romans. I'm not sure if it had crossed over to the Romans from the Greeks yet, but they were collectors of world knowledge and doctrines and scrolls and scriptures, right? But it was always an attack on Israel, even in that time. You think about when it's 70 AD, Israel is burned down. History will tell you that was the last time that the true black, brown, melanated, polished brass, as Solomon says, and see, they don't teach you that about the scriptures, but the scriptures tell you exactly who these people is. As Solomon says in Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 4, draw me, we will run after thee. The king have brought me into his chambers. We will be glad and rejoice in thee. We will remember thy love more than wine, the upright love of thee. I am black, but comely. Solomon said it. The word for black is shakur, properly dusky, but also absolutely jetty black. I said that to a so-called Ashkenazi European Jew one day. He was like, that word didn't mean black. You know, he tried to school me. Well, you know, when it talks about black in the Bible, it's talking about like a person's personality or, you know, where their mind state is and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, no, that ain't what they're talking about. We were on a comment board on YouTube going back and forth. This was when I did that. And he was like, matter of fact, let me check. You know, you're just reading the Bible in English. They done sent y'all off in America. Let me get the Hebrew for you. A couple hours go by, I get a notification on my YouTube that I was added in a reply. And he was on there. I expected him to come back and try to give me some spin. And low key, when I jumped back on the reply, he replied and said, you know what? I never knew that. That is talking about the color of his skin. I remember laughing at that for days. Like, look at y'all. He made this Ashkenazi come say that to me. I know he didn't want to say that to me. He was like, I looked into the Hebrew of that word and the root, and you know, we got all the scrolls, and because we the people and we speak the language and we always have. He hit me back and said, I never noticed that. That black does mean the color of his skin. Man, I laughed at that for so long. I didn't even tell him I told you, so I didn't even respond. I just left him to ponder that on his own. Like, because if his say Solomon was black, and you Ashkenazis is in Israel say that you the tribe of Judah, which Solomon is David's son, the tribe of Judah, how he jetty black and say, and all of y'all lily white. I just left him to ponder that for himself. I pray that Yah gave him some strengthening in that. But I read that to say, the Bible tells you what these folks look like. Just like it told us the Messiah would have feet of polished brass as it burned in the furnace. Brass is already brown. You burn it in a furnace, it becomes a dark brown. Solomon goes on to say, look not upon me, I am black. Because the sun have looked up on me. Not only am I black, I'm brown. I've been out in the sun. Y'all know how I be. I don't know about y'all in the south. Y'all may not have this, but up here in the winter and in the north, in the winter, you may get a little lighter from sitting in the house. That sun come out, you be out in the summer. That's something we say up here. Like, I could tell you've been outside all summer. You done got black. That's something we say. Like, I could tell you've been outside. You done got dark out here. Solomon said, the sun done been up on me the same way it be up on you. And even your brown can get darker if you out in that sun long enough. These folks always know who Israel is. The Bible tell who they is. Solomon is the son of David. So how is Solomon the son of David and he jet black But then the Messiah, whose mother Mary blood traces back to David, and he got blue eyes and blonde hair. Hey, yo. Hey, yo, that's crazy. You know what? Typically, when you hear people talk about the Song of Solomon, typically when you hear people talk about the Song of Solomon, a lot of times people say it's one of the harder books to read because it's kind of like it's poetic, it's almost like riddle. But I think that's one of the reasons why in the doctrine of Catholicism and Christianity, which was created by Europeans, that there isn't a focus on this book because of scriptures like this. The Romans put Pilate with the Hebrews, which is how our people do, sell out our own to the Europeans, trying to get ahead. I know y'all done heard about that interview Cat Williams just did. I don't know what all Cat Williams stand for, but what was he talking about? Black folks who will sell out their own people trying to get ahead with the Europeans. Boy, I tell you, y'all got a way to show. Same way they sold out the Messiah. If this was ancient times right now, all of them comedians that Cat Williams was talking about, I'll be telling Pilate, you need to crucify him. He a rabble rouser. He gonna start a rebellion. Right now, they'll be saying that about him. You need to put him in jail or something before he starts up. It's the same. They burn Jerusalem down in 70 AD. Go study Rome the way the Israelites retreated. All 12 tribes were spread throughout known Rome, going all the way back into Europe. This is how you got the Moors in Europe. When you hear these black men talk about, I'm a Moor. Moor just mean black. A Moor, that don't even mean nothing. The word Moor just mean that your skin black. When you hear these black men talk about the Moors and the Moors was kings and queens and this and that in Europe, that may be true. Study the history of the Moors. When they came from Africa, how did they get up there and become to get that stronghold? Because the black Israelites that was there helped them, taught them the languages, taught them the ways of them Europeans that we were already spread amongst. And the Moors took advantage of that and became something in Europe. That's a fact. But the Europeans allowed the Moors to do that. You know who they didn't allow to do it? Whose skin was just as black as ours. You know who they didn't allow to do that? Us. You get to the 13, 1400s, the Spanish Inquisition. Study it. There's books written about it. Black Israel was there. The Catholics said, if y'all don't come cross over to Christianity, if y'all don't admit that this Messiah white and start to keep Christmas, stop keeping Passover and sacrificing these animals and doing all that, wearing these fringes and all of those things, wearing dreads, these things that you do that don't nobody else do, we're gonna kick y'all out of Spain. In the books, it says that it was European Ashkenazi Jews, these ones who claim to be us now, amongst our people then. They knew who we was then. They sided with the Catholics. They was like, we about out and do what y'all do. What did they do? The Catholics in Portugal and all through Spain and all of that, they sent them Israelites to Western Africa, the known tribe of Judah. They were calling them in Europe. I'm just trying to show you this world has always been drunk with the blood of the saints, but the saints ain't somebody because he go to church every Sunday or she go to church every Sunday. You know, that's what we call a saint now. Just because you go to church every Sunday, you know, grandma wear the big old hat, tithe all the money. She a saint. That ain't what that mean in the Bible. That's man talking. That's Negroes just talking. I've seen in my upbringing men and women who go to church every Sunday tithe the most money. Be deacons and bishops and pastors and the first ladies and all of that, right? And they be called saints. Do some of the most scandalous things. That ain't what a saint is. When they say a saint, it's talking about Israel, set apart righteous Israel. And in Mystery Babylon, that woman has always been drunk with the blood of the saints. They kicked them people out of Spain. Our ancestors, they put them in Western Africa. Papal bull come from the Pope, 1492, Christopher Columbus and all of them. To go into the New World, you could take human, they made it legal in Europe to take human, I think the word they call it is chattel slavery. I'm not for sure, I don't know these terms, but they legalize transporting slaves with them for the establishment of the New World for Europe. Papal Bull 1492. A pope did that. You know where they first stop was? Go get them niggas we just sent down to Western Africa. What do they teach you about slavery? We don't know what tribe you is. We don't know what nation you from. But we know that most of the ports where they grabbed you from was where? In Western Africa, where we had just put you at. They been drunk with the blood of the saints. Know that. Know that. Transatlantic slavery, Arabic slavery, same thing. The Arabs, I showed you all that. The Palestinians owned slaves. Up until 1870, I seen, they were still transporting slaves. They were doing it longer than these white folks in America. Them same Palestinians today will tell you black people, you need to stand with us because of what America and these Jews and these Europeans is doing to us in the Gaza. He'll never tell you that his ancestors benefited and owned slaves just like these white folks. I heard one of them say before, y'all bogus if you stand with these white folks. Look at what they did with your people. I told her, no, the Palestinians, I was like, well, you know, it was a different time and y'all owned them longer than the white folks. But we supposed to stand with them. During slavery, an innocent slave, a European could make up a lie about an innocent slave and they would hang him from a tree. Just like a Mashiach, he could be innocent and get hung from a tree. They've always been drunk with the blood of the saints. And Yah ended Isaiah 49 by saying, I'm going to feed them that oppress thee with their own flesh. We know he wasn't talking about the Ashkenazis in Israel because Hitler and the Germans and the Holocaust and all that, the world stepped in and pay and do all of this to get them down into what they were calling Palestine, what they call Israel today. And Germany's still there. Didn't lose nothing. They're still one of the top nations in the world. They ain't been no pre- they ain't been they ain't been fed with their own flesh and drunk with their own blood. No. But all flesh, Yah say, and he ain't gonna know that I am Yah, thy Savior and thy Redeemer, the mighty one of your code. That's how we know that ain't true. Because that ain't how this done happened. In Isaiah chapter 50, he goes in and he says, thus saith the Most High Yah, where is the bill of your mother's divorcement, whom I have put away? Ironically, right in this awakening, this Israelites who use the verse in Hosea, the prophet Hosea, there's a verse that talks about the 10 northern tribes before they go into slavery, and he talks about divorcing them. And one of these so-called waking Israelites will use that verse to say, well, you know, he divorced the northern tribes. That's why in the Bible, when it talks about Gentiles, it's talking about the northern tribes. And in his small understanding of Torah, his only ideal of a Gentile is somebody white. The Asians ain't Gentiles. The indigenous slash conquistador mixed Latins ain't Gentiles. The Hamites, just as black as us, ain't Gentiles. Not only these white folks, these Europeans. They're the only Gentiles. When I was reading this verse not yesterday, I feel like I've been reading Isaiah 50 and 51 all week. But I thought, well, who is he talking about divorcing right here? By the time you get to Isaiah chapter 50, the 10 northern tribes long been gone. So who is he talking about the bill of divorcement here? Isaiah's in Jerusalem. And he going to tell you, because when we get to the bottom, he going to say, oh, Jerusalem, what the hell you got going on? The same thing some of y'all say when you see Israelites doing whatever it is that we do. Some of y'all be looking like, what in the hell is going on with our people? Like, I think that when I see gangs, when I see young folks still in gangs, in my mind, I'm thinking, how's people still in gangs, man? We done had a 40, 50 year run seeing gangs don't do nothing but destroy our own community. And these people in these other nations love gangs and gang members, man. We the best at killing our own. They don't even got to kill us no more, man. Put some pistols in the neighborhood and get them some drugs to sell. They'll do a better job than we ever did. That's how they look at us. Where is the bill of your divorcement, whom I have put away? He talk about Jerusalem. Which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? You ain't just in. The white man didn't just. I just told you the papal bull was the pope and all that. You know why all that was able to happen? Because Yah was like, Israel, you done fell up under these curses. And you got to pay it forward or my word will go out void and that can't happen. And I told you, you're going to get on them boats and go on slave ships if you break these commandments. Might not be you. Your descendants will. Jacob's 10 sons sold Joseph into slavery down into Egypt. When they got there, Joseph told them, I forgive y'all. Because Pharaoh was blessing him, he gave him Goshen, which was the best of the land in Egypt. They gave him plenty of gold, silver, rubies, clothes, wine, cattle. In the time of Jacob's sons, Jacob and his sons' lives in Egypt, they were probably the richest people in Egypt. After Ephraim and Manasseh die, I'll say about a generation out from them. So not them, not Judah and Issachar and all of them. Probably not their children. But by the time you get to their grandchildren, Exodus said that rose a Pharaoh that didn't know Joseph. And what did that Pharaoh do? He put their children into slavery. Because you reap what you sow. My word won't go out void. Yeah, Joseph forgave y'all. And I use that to save this world, even to save y'all. I use Joseph in Egypt to save the world. Y'all like, yeah, I did that. Y'all will never see slavery a day of y'all life. Jacob's children who sold him here. Y'all live fat into the end of y'all lives. But your children got to go. Just like here. A lot of us today, we ain't know nothing about Israel and the curses and what our ancestors did. But you still got to go. Don't ever let nobody tell you the white man did this to me and the white. No, he didn't. Because y'all say right here, of which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? See, can't nobody do nothing to you unless y'all say. If you don't take nothing from reading the Bible, always remember this when you read it. Ain't nobody ever been able to do nothing to Israel unless y'all say. When y'all fighting for Israel, there is nothing nobody can do. On the same token, when y'all fighting against Israel, there is nothing nobody can do. No, I sold you. Behold, why? Because your iniquities have sold yourselves. You sold yourself by the way you carry this. You sell yourself today by the way you carry this. And for your transgressions is your mother put away. You're talking to Jerusalem. I would ask one of these so-called Israelites that talk like that, so do that mean that everybody was divorced? So that mean every Israelite was a Gentile. And we know that's a lie. Some of this stuff, man, is like so easy to, I shouldn't say easy, but to me it's in plain view. But do we want to see it? See, once we come into this truth and knowledge puff us up, we can't even see ourselves sometimes no more. I've been encountering that a lot lately. And we're going to get to it. It's going to come up. Wherefore, he says, when I came, was there no man? When I called, was there none to answer? Because y'all done got too caught up into yourself, who going to answer? I thought about this in today's time. With all this bickering going back and forth over these trivial matters, with knowledge having blinded a lot of Israel. Because I understand, and I know a lot of you notice we've talked about this, knowledge has become the barometer of what's an awakened Israelite in the men and the women, ironically. You kind of expect that in the men. You don't really expect that in the women, but it's the same. Knowledge has become the barometer. And with us doing all of that, because we don't study to show ourselves approved, we study to act like we know better than everybody. Real talk. We study to act like we know better than everybody. And with all that being done, if y'all came right now, who would be able to answer? Who's paying enough attention? And when I mean paying attention, not just in scripture and what you see, because only the righteous will truly hear the call. So while we doing all this studying to add his knowledge and to puff up, who's really living out the name of Yah? This is why the name is so important. Because when you talk about the name of Yah, it ain't really about the name. You know, Exodus has been on my mind a lot, and I'm probably going to mention it a few times. I thought back when Moses was at the burning bush, it said an angel of Yah was at the burning bush and told him, "You're going to go down here. I put the words in your mouth. I do this and that." The only angel who would be saying that I am God and I put these words in your mouth is Hamashiach. Moses met the Messiah. That's who was in the burning bush talking to him. And the angel said, "You're going to go back down there, and I have heard the cries of my people." Michael and Gabriel and all of them have never talked like that in scripture. The only quote unquote angel in scripture who would talk like that is the Messiah. And Moses basically was like, because I hear Moses at this bush, he said, "Man, you know, I grew up in Pharaoh's house. I grew up rich. I grew up amongst these European, or not even these Europeans. I grew up amongst these Hamitic Africans, these Gentiles. And because the woman who raised, or she didn't raise me, my mother raised me in this woman's house. But the woman house we were in was Pharaoh's daughter. I grew up really close to Pharaoh. Now, Israel don't know this, but I've been fighting for them my whole life in Pharaoh's house. I done fought for them to get the Shabbat off. I done fought for them to lessen this burden on them. I done fought for them so much I saw an Egyptian treating one of them bad. I killed the man and they told him." Is what he told Yah, which is what we do. "I slayed an Egyptian for an Israelite, and the Israelite told the Egyptians I did it." If that ain't us. And he said, "You telling me to go down here with this staff and do all these miracles and all this stuff gonna happen?" He said, "They ain't gonna hear me. Them folks don't hear me now. Not all of them, but a lot of them act funny towards me." This is what he told that angel in the bar. A lot of them act funny towards me. Take all the thous and theys and yeas out. That ain't how Moses was talking. Moses said, "Them Hebrews be acting funny. And I done got comfortable here. I'm content with my wife. I don't want to go deal with them Hebrews." And Yah said, "You gonna go deal with them. Because I told you gonna go." And obedience is, as we just read in Psalms, obedience has always been before everything. Before the sacrifice and all that, this calling has always been a calling to obedience, which is what today is about. It's time to put off all of that knowledge and who knows scriptures and trying to correct each other's understanding of the scriptures and being wrong. I seen somebody recently do that. That used to be a pet peeve of mine. Now I just laugh. Don't be trying to correct nobody use of scripture and then your correction be wrong. You out of order for that, right? Moses said, "I'm not finna go deal with them folks." Y'all said, "Yes, you is." He said, "Well, look, this is how I know it ain't about the name." He said, "Well, who should I tell them sent me if I go do that?" And y'all told Moses, "Go down there and tell them Yahuwah, Barak Hashem, in the name of Yahawashah. Go down there and tell them Yahuwah, Yahusha, Yeshua, Yahashua, Yahuwah, Yahuwah, what else we say? Yah, whatever. Go down there and tell them that. Go down there. Make sure you run down there and tell them folks my name." No, that ain't what he said. He said, "Go down there and tell them Ahaya, Ashir, Ahaya." And in Hebrew, that translates to, "Negro, get down there and tell him I am who I am." He didn't tell him to go tell him his name. He didn't tell him to go tell him Yah, to go tell him you, none of that. He said, "You go down there and tell them I am who I am. And they better get it together. But you go teach them that they got to clean themselves up. You go encourage and inspire them to be obedient, to put back on righteousness, to treat his brother better, to treat his mother better, to treat his husband, her, him or her husband or wife better. That's what you go teach them. You go teach them they need to start praying more. All that sacrifice is cool, but they need to start praying more. They need to start repenting more. That's what you go tell them, Moses." Moses said, "Who?" He said, "Go tell them I am who I am." Not today. You know what we do today? We go stand in front of some elder who ain't never heard none of that, and we get to talk about some Baruch Yahuwah, Baha Wabash, Hashem. What? They looking at you like, boy, what? Kind of jar. It's the same as speaking in tongues. People in these churches be speaking in tongues, claiming they speaking in Hebrew. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where it talk about the gifts, it said that if you speaking in tongues and ain't nobody interpreting, then you doing that to edify yourself. That's what this awakening is about. We doing all this to edify ourselves. That ain't the win. No, just go tell them I am who I am. Because the name don't really mean nothing. It's the character of the name as far as you. Now, it's power in the name once you get the character right. They asked Paul, said the Gentiles be circumcised? He said, well, I'm going to tell them to cut their flesh and they don't even know to keep the laws yet. Who this cutting their flesh going to do and they ain't keeping no laws? They don't know nothing about right, true righteousness. What is that going to do? No, I'll go teach them that first. With a man here to call, with us acting the way we be acting. Is my hand shortened at all that he cannot redeem? Y'all done forgot. Y'all don't want to hear the call. Y'all done forgot who I am. Or have I no power to deliver? Behold, at my rebuke, I dry up the sea. I make the rivers a wilderness. Their fish stink because there is no water and die for thirst. Look, be cool. I got y'all. Just be cool. You serving the one who does that. Put down all this knowledge as power, Israel, and start to teach your people to live better, to treat each other better. Get understanding before you just be speaking out of turn. It'd be a lot of that. Verse 3, I clothe the heaven with blackness and I make sackcloth their covering. This is the Elohim that's talking to you. Us. This is the Elohim that chose our people. The one who clothed the heavens with blackness. When you go out tonight and you look up in the sky, if it's clear, and all you can see is dots in the sky that look like light, and you can't see nothing but blackness, remember, Yah said, I did that. You don't deserve to just look into the heavens. When you read the books of Adam and Eve, when they were in the garden, they could look straight into the heavens. Jacob's ladder. When Jacob had the dream, he said he saw angels ascending and descending on a ladder, which was really a staircase going into heaven, showing the levels of heaven. Yah allowed him to see from earth on the ground into the heavens. No, not nobody else. No, I clothed it with blackness. I make sackcloth their covering. You don't deserve to just look into heaven. You lost that privilege when Adam wasn't obedient. That's when you lost that. The Most High Yah have given me the tongue of the learned. See, this is why a lot of that nonsense is crazy. What do it say right here? Yeah, I like that. You ain't just gathered his knowledge. You don't just know. Who's you to think you know? I'm a highlighter at swallow. So I'm like, highlight my swallow? It is wild. That's crazy. Now, there we go. The Most High Yah have given me the tongue of the learned. You ain't just studied into this. This is why you remain humble. You don't just know. I allowed you this in the Septuagint. The Most High has given me the tongue of instruction to know when it is fit to speak a word. A lot of Israelites in this awakening don't know when it's fit to speak a word. They don't know how. They don't know when. They don't know the proper way to relay it. That's why I'd be a lot of nonsense being thrown around. He has appointed for me early. He has given me an ear to hear. Yah has done that. You don't just know. And the instruction of Yah, the Most High, opens mine ears, and I do not disobey nor dispute. When Yah opened our ears and our eyes, and he woke us up and gave us this understanding of the learned, this understanding of instruction, the same understanding Hamashiach gave the disciples, the first thing we should do is not disobey. This calling has always been a calling to obedience. It's not about who know the most scriptures. It's not about who know the most precepts. It's not about who weird doctrine is this or who that. And I say that respectfully because I have some bold ideas in Torah. But I don't come in here on Shabbat and try to force them on y'all. Even if I feel like I can prove them in Torah, I ain't trying to force them on y'all. The point of this, for all of you who do not know, the point of what we doing here, this started with my mother, with my wife's mother, with my brother, and a couple other of my friends locally. None of them knew anything about the truth. Yah had woke me and my wife up, but we agreed to start a Zoom call. When we started that call, the point of this has always been to encourage and inspire them to care more about Yah. Nothing more, nothing less. Even with some of you Israelites in here now, who I have a high respect for, because some of you know this Torah better than me. Some of you know the language better than me. Some of you have been in this longer than me. But never forget that the point of this still to this day is to inspire and encourage those who are here who don't know anything about none of this. And the first step we try and inspire is to be obedient. Because in verse 5, Yah said, I woke you up to all of that, to not disobey. That's the point of all of this. That's what we teach in here. I have some big ideas in Torah. Now, some of you, I've talked about some big ideas in Torah who are on that level. And we are iron sharpening iron. But we ain't coming in here forcing no ideas on nobody. No. You're just trying to encourage and inspire somebody to go be better. Most people don't even believe you can keep the laws of the Bible or these feast days and all that. We're just trying to inspire and encourage somebody that is possible. When Yah opened mine ears, I do not disobey. When he first opened my ears, I was still disobeying. When the Most High first opened my ears, I was still in the club. I was still chasing skirts. I was still selling dope and keeping the Shabbat. I'm so thankful he look at me and be like, this Negro here, he just go. No, he was patient with me. I know he was patient with me too. He was patient with me. He gave me about a year of doing that. Well, I said about 8 months. He allowed me to do that. And then one day I woke up and I heard him say, it's time to stop selling dope. And I just stopped selling dope. Asked my wife. One day I woke up and I heard Yah say, it's time to stop selling dope. I ain't blessed you with this understanding. Because I knew I was learning, though. I was in the Bible. I ain't blessed you with that to still be destroying your own people. And I just stopped selling dope. I sold the little drugs I had in my house and I never went and bought no more. Because it was time to be obedient. And we say those things, that testimony, to inspire you. You can come out of that. You might still be working on something. You can come out of that. I do not disobey nor dispute. I give my back to Scrooges and my cheeks to blows. And I turn not away my face from the shame of spitting. He ain't say go let me. You know, that's that. He ain't saying just go let nobody beat on you. He's saying right there, although you may be down and out, although you might have been felt beat on, don't turn away. Don't turn away. But although you may be in shame, you know, feel like you being spit in the face is like the most shameful thing. Although you feel like you are living in shame, although you've been beat, although you've been down and out, remember, Yahuwah is your helper. Remember that, even though you're down and out. Therefore, I was not ashamed. Yeah, they didn't call me a nigger. Yeah, they didn't call me a coon and a spook and a monkey and all of that. And yeah, they done did that to me too. No, don't be ashamed. We checking them too, but still don't be ashamed. Still don't be ashamed. No, because they don't know. No, they don't know. You Israel, remember that. Carry yourself like royalty. See, we taught that. Well, you know, we come from kings and queens and Israel and we this and we that. Then we still carry ourselves like peasants though, in the manner of how we carry, how we deal with each other, how we talk to each other. No, but I set my face as a solid rock and I know that I shall never be ashamed. Why? Because now I know I'm Israel and now I'm obedient to the calling that Yah has put upon Israel. See, it don't matter just because you know Israel with some black folks. That don't mean nothing either. But we gonna obey what Yah is telling us. Verse 8, for he that has justified me draws near. Oh, do we? He that has justified me draws near. Y'all see these earthquakes and the way this world looking? This world so crazy, these people in Miami said they seen an alien. You know what? I don't know if that's true or false. But when I heard that story, my first thought was, boy, y'all got this world so crazy. People don't know what they see. And then I seen a video of like 30 young Negroes jumping on this one boy. And I said, yeah, I see aliens too. Them niggas.
Yo.
Yeah, I saw some aliens too. I saw black shadows too. 30 mil Negroes stomping some man. I saw them too. I feel y'all in my head because I saw them too. And they was some young Negroes wilding. Oh, man. Y'all gotta forgive me. I got a weird sense of humor, man. But that tickled me. I ain't gonna lie to you. Oh man, that tickled me. He who has justified you draw near. Who is he that pleads with me? The word here for pleads, I believe. Did I circle that? Where I'm at here? No, not yet. Let him stand up against me at the same time. Let him stand up against me. Whoever contends with me, let him stand up against me. Yeah. Who is he that pleads with me? Let him draw nigh to me. You have contention with me, more than likely for the word. You have contention with me over scripture, and you wrong. Let him stand up against me. Understand, we take for granted. When Isaiah and these prophets is writing these scriptures and these prophecies and all that, they ain't made no scripture about a Christian, a Catholic, a Muslim, a Buddhist, none of that. They don't care nothing about none of that. They talking about Israel against Israel. Let them stand. Because at the time of Isaiah, the problem is Israel is wild. They against their brother. It's violence, as the scriptures say, and murder and blood in the streets of Jerusalem. We've been doing that. We've been doing that. We've been doing that. We following the gods. We committing spiritual adultery as well as physical adultery. Spiritual adultery is we following the gods of the people around, just like today. Let them draw near, because the one who justified me draws near. Behold, the Most High Yah will help me. Who will hurt me? Behold, all you shall wax old as a garment, and a moth shall devour you. He's talking to Israel. See, an awakened Israelite use this scripture to be telling you about some white folks and these people and T.D. Jakes, and they fall up under that, a lot of them. Don't get it twisted. He's talking about Israel. Israel that be recklessly going against their own is going to wax old like a garment, and a moth shall devour them. Don't you believe that notion that just because you black in Israel and you got the blood of an Israelite that you're gonna be okay. That ain't Torah. That ain't Torah. That ain't Torah. Not at all. The blood, the mystery Babylon was drunk with the blood of the saints. The saints were the Israelites who were being obedient. No. If you go roguely out here just killing folks and you get the death penalty, no, you ain't the saint. And you just went and shot up the mall because you didn't get a job. No, that don't make you a saint. No. He's talking to Israel. Behold, all of you shall wax old. Let's not be the one that wax old as a garment and a moth devours. Mind you, we all may die, but let's not do it in shame, is what he's saying. Who is among you that fears Yah? Who? When I read this, I said, we got a ways to go, but I'm gonna leave you all with this at the end. I want you to think about that. Of all of the people that you've met that claim to be in Torah, who do you believe really fears Yah? And not only that, I want you to think about this. Do you really fear Yah? I'm gonna think about the same. Don't get it twisted. I'm gonna do the same. I can't ask you to do. I ain't gonna do it. I've been thinking about this all week, though. I listened to this like Monday. I had this plan in here Monday, and this kind of been on my mind all week. Who have I met that really fears Yah? Who have I met in this walk that really fears Yah? I ain't gonna throw no names out there because I don't want nobody to feel like I excluded them. I'm just kidding. But it's something I ponder. Like, who have I met that really fears Yah? You know somebody, I will throw a name out there. One person who I've met in this truth, and it's a lot of you all, don't take this the wrong way, but one person who I will throw out there who from the time I've met them in the conversations we've had. And I could be wrong, I'm just a man. But I feel like that's somebody who really fear Yah, who really chasing after Yah, who really trying to get this right, is Mama Speed. I can't lie. I done thought a lot of things about Mama Speed. But one thing I done always knew from the time I done met her, that's a Coatee who fear Yah. That's somebody who I will say, because she's bold and boisterous, but I could tell she's serious about what she's saying. And I tell that about most of you as well, all of you, really. I'm not even saying that, but that's somebody who I feel like really fears y'all. Let him hearken to the voice of his servant. You that walk in darkness and have no light, trust in the name of Yah and stay up on Elohim. You that walk in darkness and have no light, you better find the servants of Yah. Hamashiach is the number one servant, but there are servants out here. You better find them. When you get around one, you better pay attention. You that walk in darkness and have no light, trust in the name of Yah. You that walk in darkness, more than likely, you ain't never heard of the name of Yah, but you know his character. You know he's supposed to be loving kindness, or he is, has shows loving kindness, mercy, forgiveness, compassion, teaches us honor and humility, humbleness, meekness. So you ain't never got to hear the name of Yah to know that that's how it's supposed to be, though. Trust in that. If you ain't never heard the name of not Yah, Bahashem, Yahawashah, if you ain't never heard all of that, one thing you better know is you better learn that character. You better know that character. If you ain't never knew none of that, you better know what he stand for. Because that's the more important thing. It ain't about the name. You better know what he stand for. And you need to be trying to stand for the same things. Behold, you all kindle a fire and feed a flame. Walk in the light of your fire and in the flame which you have kindled. Y'all done got too puffed up. No, you think this about you. You got a little too full of yourself, Ak. You got a little too full of yourself, Akoti. That's the same thing hurt your ancestors in Israel. Read the Old Testament. Y'all put our people in Israel. He was giving them, as the scriptures say, he was giving them rain in season. He was increasing the land for them. The cattle was plush, the milk, the honey, the olives, the grapes, the gold, the garments. We had it all. What we do? Solomon took a wife of the Philistines, start worshiping Molech. Boy, how you do that? You got everything. Think about that, man. Just like these celebrities today, though. Just like these celebrities today. You got everything. What's the first thing? What's the first thing our men, I'll say? Our women starting to do it too, but our men. What's the first thing our men do here in America when they get a little money, some fame, some stature? We gonna marry a woman of another nation. Solomon. That's the first thing we do. Hey, tell me I'm lying. That's the first thing we do. I seen this video before on Twitter, and it was, somebody made it. I know they was being funny, but it was like, current star basketball players and all their wives. All the star basketball players was African-American. Like 85% of them wives was of other nations. I think the only ones who had wives of this of their own nation was like Wade and LeBron. Everybody else had married something else. Everybody. Solomon. Yay said that and did this exact same thing. Solomon, you got everything, and the first thing you do is go sacrifice to Molech. Now, if you mess with one of the women of another nation, in Solomon's case, that wasn't his issue. His issue was you went and worshiped her God with her. What's wrong with you? Knowing that you served the Elohim. But see, he kindled his own fire. What else did Solomon have? The same as these Israelites. Solomon had real wisdom. These Israelites today just be talking. Solomon had real wisdom. But see, he was kindling his own fire. He was walking in his own light. This is what a lot of Israel disawakening does today. And Yah said, you better get that in order, because that's happened to you for my sake. You shall lie down in sorrow. I'm allowing you. That's why we got to be able to check ourselves. I'm allowing you to be running around here fronting and stunting like that. You're going to lay down in sorrow. You know why? Because you claiming to represent my name. If you represent my name, you don't represent my name. Oh, I'm doing this in the name of Yah. No, you ain't. How you doing it in the name of Yah and you don't know how to show no mercy? Because the name of Yah represents showing mercy. He showed it to us. That's how we ended up at this point. No, you're going to lay down in sorrow. Any questions or comments on chapter 50 so I can get through 51? Hallelujah. We've been awakened to obedience. Remember that. That's the theme of today. This awakening ain't about no whole bunch of knowledge. It's this ain't about no, even the fellowshipping and keeping the feast and all of that. That's a beautiful thing. That ain't what this awakening is about. We are supposedly right now planning a Passover dinner here in Chicago for all of you that may want to come. Hallelujah. I think it's going to be a beautiful thing. But even that fellowshipping amongst each other, that ain't what this awakening is about. The first, now that's a part of it. But the first thing this awakening is about is we got to get obedient. We have to represent not the name, but the character of the name. That's how you represent the name, by displaying that character. Any questions or comments, anything anybody want to add in Isaiah chapter 50 before we move on? Hallelujah. In chapter 51, we're going to keep it moving. After y'all talk about you go lie down in sorrow because you doing too much, he start the next chapter with hearken to me. But hold on now. Listen to me. He said, hold on. Listen to me. You that follow after righteousness, not them that's in this to do too much and to be reckless and to be and to not be decent and in order. See, we know the laws. We talk the commandments and the feasts and all that. This Bible is a whole, it's a statute much bigger than just that. Love Yah. Learn to love your brother. Be decent and in order. It's funny, man. Some of the most scripturally sound Israelites is the main ones that's forever never decent and in order. How that work? But know all the scriptures, though. Hearken to me, you that follow after righteousness. Those of you who understand that you've been called to be obedient first, to represent this name the right way, because that's how you be righteous. You have to learn to represent this name the right way. Y'all, though, hold on. You that seek after Yah, the name. You that seek after being humble, showing humility. You that seek after doing what's right to your folks, to your family, to the stranger, because you don't know if you're dealing with an angel underwear. You look unto the rock which you were young. Now look to the rock which you were young. And to the hole of the pit where you were digged. He's saying in verse 1, don't forget where you come from. You've been out here reckless too. Don't forget where you come from. You come from a hard place too. The hole of the pit which you dig, the pit is death, the grave, hell. You was digging a hole down there too. And now you seek after righteousness. Don't forget where you come from, Israelite. Verse 2, look unto Abraham, Ibrahim, your father, and unto Sarah that bare you. For I called him alone and blessed him and increased him. Remember, Abraham was in Babylon. The walls was closing in on him too. Now, he was faithful. Nimrod had made calls on his life. His daddy, Terah, was against him, told him, Nimrod, my son, Abraham, he destroyed your statues. The walls was closing in on him too. For the Most High, Yah shall comfort who? Zion, the church. No. Christianity. No. The saints of the church. No. The Most High Yah gonna comfort Zion, the saints within Israel, and any Gentile amongst Israel who's trying to live and be the same type of saint that an Israelite has to be. He will comfort all our waste places. He will make her wilderness like Eden and her desert like the garden of Yah. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving and the voice of melody. Even though you've been living for death, just like Abraham, you've been called for something greater. He used Abraham as an example. Abraham was in Babylon too. Everybody was against him too. I called him out alone. The initial calling may not be on everybody around you. I called you first. But what did Abraham do? He went on to teach and to preach and to encourage and to inspire everybody he came across about Yah. At the end of his life, what did Yah say about him? That's my man. Hey, yo. At the end of the life, Yah told one of them, I don't even know where that scripture is where he called him his friend, but I just don't hear Yah saying that. I hear him telling them, Abraham was my man at the end of all of this. That was my man's. He was a real one. That's what he told him. I can't even think of what that scripture is. Abraham is my friend. I think Abraham is the only person. Might be an act somewhere. Maybe verse chapter 7. I don't know. But if I'm mistaken, I think Abraham is the only person in Torah that Yah said was his friend. I really do. I really do. I think Hamashiach called him his brother. In Hebrews, like chapter 1 and 2, I want to say Hamashiach said that Abraham was his brother. He was in Babylon too. Even though we've been digging this hole in the hill and living for death under doctrines of Europeans and oppressors, because not just Europeans, our people spread all over the world under doctrines of these Arabs in the Middle East, which is a doctrine of death, under doctrines in Asia, having been assimilated in the Philippines and in Indonesia and in China and in Japan. And that was a doctrine of death. Although you've been assimilated into all these doctrines of death all around the world, because it ain't just about it. In Africa, amongst Black Hermetic Africans, assimilating to Pan-Africanism and all these weird gods, and everybody black is your brother. Africans don't never. That's one of the silly. It's funny because the Negroes who try to act the smartest amongst our people today in America is the Negroes who talk about Pan-Africanism. Yet that's actually one of the silliest premises that they push it. Everything in Africa, black is a brother. Because when you talk to Africans who migrate here, my uncle just married a woman, a Yoruba, right? From Nigeria. She'll tell you in the dough in Nigeria, just because you black them people, you ain't everybody, brother. What tribe you from starts that. That's one of the biggest lies, and we pushing that now. But that's been given to us by the oppressor. Everything in Africa, black. The reason why they gave that to the slaves, because they never wanted you to look deeper and say, damn, the Igbo say that they the descendants of Judah. And the Limba say, certain tribes in Africa say, you know, the Limba say they're the descendants of the Levites. And, you know, you got the tribes. I can't think of all the names of the tribe because certain tribes call it, though. I know it's a tribe over there say they're the descendants of Reuben. It's a tribe over there say they're the descendants of Gad. It's a tribe over there say they're the descendants of Dan. Now, everybody within the tribe don't subscribe to that and follow, just like every African-American don't believe he's an Israelite. Hell, half of these African Americans, you can't even tell them the Messiah black. They throw you out their house. Oh, color skin ain't got nothing to do with it. You one of them. You got to go off. All right. Y'all done heard it. No, you've been called out of death. You've been called to something greater, just like Abraham. Don't forget it. You've been called to something greater, just like Abraham. Don't forget it. Hearken unto me, my people, Zion, Israel, those who follow, hearken unto me. And give ear unto me, O my nation, for a law. The word here for law. The word here for law. Let me get to this. The word here for law. A law. What law? Torah. Especially the Decalogue, meaning the Ten Commandments. Especially. Torah shall proceed from me, and I will make my judgment to rest for a light of the people. My righteousness is near. My salvation is going forth, and my arms, the yod, I wish Camille was here, the hand, the one that I sent to do this work, shall judge the people. He came last time, he said, I didn't come to judge. I just came to encourage, to inspire. When I come back with these angels, I'm coming to judge. I think 1 Peter chapter 4. And Peter said, judgment is going to start at the house of Israel. That's why you got it so hard. Ain't no black cloud just over you. Judgment is going to start at the house of Israel. The isles, the countries shall wait up on me, and on mine arm shall they trust. Torah came from Yah. Hamashiach is the light of the world. I will make my judgment to rest for a light of the people. Who the light of the world now? He's still the light, but who's the light? If it's dark out and he the moon, who the stars? Us. We got to go let the light of Yah shine. We don't let the light of Yah shine trying to out-precept each other. Matter of fact, that's an L. I told y'all that once before. I ain't giving nobody a precept. I have to really have love for you and respect you on a level to give you a precept for anything. I give somebody ignorant a precept, though, just because they don't understand and we trying to get them to see. But because I'm standing amongst some black folks because they know they're Israelites and we having a conversation and they need a precept trying to justify themselves, I ain't giving you nothing. I'm telling you just like I'm not even giving you a chapter and a verse. Didn't Isaiah say law was going to proceed out of y'all? Period. Well, what I said, you should know you standing in front of me acting like you know all the scriptures. I give it to one of y'all. We build it in love, but man, these Negroes, they just be throwing these scriptures out. I wish I would. And on top of that, in my experience, the Negroes who I catch constantly trying to correct people in their scriptural knowledge to a real one be wrong. I just ain't the one to be calling everything out. Be wrong. Don't be correcting nobody in scripture and you wrong. That is like the worst thing you could do amongst a true Israelite who do this, because you don't have to do that. It's the same thing as when I'm talking to somebody, and some of you know me, I told you some of you this before. I don't ask people about their lives as far as specific things. Man, I heard you did it. No, I don't do that. How you doing? If we rock like that and I ask you, how you been doing? And you tell me, oh, I've been working, you know, I've been home with the kids, blah, 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 and woo, woo, woo. And I'm like, that's what's up. And then the next day I'm in the grocery store and I see your wife or your girlfriend or your baby mama, whatever it be. And I ask her, how you been doing? And she like, you know, just doing what I got to do. You know, I'm doing all this on my own. They daddy don't want to do nothing. Woo, woo. You offered me a lot. And I look at Israelites who throw these scriptures around and be wrong the same way I look at Negroes who just offer me a lot. Don't do that. To me, that is one of the lowest things you can do, because you playing now. You playing with my intelligence when you do that. And that's like one of my pet peeves. Do not play. Now, you can be ignorant, but do not play with my intelligence. I don't respect that because I don't play with yours. I keep it real with you. If you ask me how I'm doing, I'm going to tell you the truth about me. Don't offer me no lie, because I ain't asked you about your kids. Real talk. So don't offer me no lie when tour. If I say in the beginning, y'all created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void. And I say, well, if you look at that word was, it say the earth became without form and void, something happened. And you say, no, Ak, you know, whatever you say, and you wrong. Now you offered me a lie and I ain't asked you for that. I wasn't doing this for that. No, don't do that. I look at them Negroes who do that the same way as them folks. Don't do that. You ain't got to, because all we've been called is to be obedient. And to let the light of Yah shine. How do you let the light of Yah shine? By being obedient to the character of his name. Not his name. Not his name. It is people who are going to get into the kingdom who ain't never heard his name. You know how I know? Because a lot of slaves ain't never. Based off that premise, that means almost none of our people who were in slavery have a chance at the kingdom. And I know that's a lot. There's no way you could tell me Harriet Tubman may have never heard the name of Yah, but she ain't got a shot at the kingdom for it when she was putting her life on the line to free slaves. Something most of these Israelites today would never have the heart to do. Stop. I can't hear that. I just can't hear that. I can't hear that. Israelites sit on Zoom. Niggas find their righteousness on Zoom. I'm not hearing that. It is people out here who have put their life on the line to do what's right. Now, I ain't talking about the Negroes who've been trying to sell doctrines on our people. That's on them. That's on them. You got Black Panthers who died just saying, black people, we need to stick together and feed our children and raise our community. Just because he ain't know the name of y'all, you telling me he ain't got, that's a lie. I ain't hearing that. Because most of these Israelites today ain't even wouldn't even have a heart to do that. I'm not hearing that. No. All we got to do is go be the light. Go teach somebody how to be obedient. And let our obedience to the character of the name shine. That's it. It seems so simple, but it's really so hard. Why? Verse 6. Where are you at? Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look upon the earth beneath. Why? For the heavens shall vanish away. What you looking at one day gonna vanish away. With fervent heat, it say. That ain't no nuke. It ain't enough nukes on the planet to destroy the heavens of Yah. We don't even know how big the heavens of Yah is. They can't even get a nuke through the firmament. Like, and that's what I'm saying. Like, Israelites will tell you anything. Israelites got people scared to death right now thinking nukes gonna go off and destroy creation. No. It ain't a heat hot enough. You know what heat is, fervent heat? The heat that Yah gonna bring. No, 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 don't be, no. And the earth shall wax old like a garment, and they that dwell therein shall die in like manner. But my salvation shall be forever, and my righteousness shall not be abolished. What did Habashiach say? My salvation shall be forever. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. What did Habashiach say? I am the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Hearken unto me, you that know righteousness, the people in whose heart is Torah. Hold on. What is righteousness? The people in whose heart is Torah. Righteousness. I told you study to show yourself approved, but studying to show yourself approved don't make you righteous, Israelites. Know that. No. What makes you righteous? The people in whose heart is Torah. One of the things in Torah is decent and in order. Knowing how to show respect. And not just respect to an elder because he's older than you. Respect to whoever. I show the same respect to an elder that I will show one of y'all kids. Fear you not the reproach of men, neither be you afraid of the revilers. If you really got Torah in your heart, and you really after the righteousness, the obedience of representing the character of Yah's name, you ain't got to be worried about what, you know. And like I say, when Isaiah's write this, he ain't talking about no Christians. He ain't talking about grandma who got white Jesus all in the house and don't know no better. He ain't talking about her. No, he talk about us. He talking about you Israelites who claim to know this and know that. No, we ain't fearing the reproach of men or women. Neither be afraid of their revilers. No, they ain't even really standing on nothing anyway. Coming from my point of view, the word for heart. If you have Torah, whose heart is in the law, it's where your feelings at, your intellect, the center of anything, your mind, your understanding, your wisdom. Let that be based on the law of Yah. Let it be what guides you, is what he's saying. That's righteousness. Not all this precepting that's going on. And all this precepting that's wrong, especially. Like, nah, Negroes got to figure that out. That ain't a hunt. For the moth shall eat them up like a garment, and the worm shall eat them like wool. Once again, that's the second time he said that. Talking to Israelites. He ain't talking about no heathen. You Israelites that's playing with those who really seeking righteousness, trying to puff up yourself. Putting yourself in a situation where the moth is going to eat you up like a garment. But my righteousness shall be forever, and my salvation from generation to generation. Yeah, I was like, I'm unmoved. I'm unmoved. Those who understand that obedience, those that understand you've been awakened to be obedient first. You ain't got to fear nothing. Righteousness is going to be forever. Salvation from generation to generation. Don't let knowledge puff you up. And I say that respectfully because there's been times where I done fell off into that. But we got to correct that. And it start with correcting yourself. It start with correcting yourself. Awake. Awake, O Jerusalem. See what I'm saying? When he was talking about divorcement, he ain't talking about no 10 northern tribes. He said, Jerusalem, it's time to wake up. Yehuda. They believed that the transatlantic slave trade was Yehuda. Why? Because they knew that them black Israelites, them black Jews during the Spanish Inquisition, if any of you think I'm lying, you need to Google that and look that up. That's history. They don't teach it in no history class, but there's books written about it all in Oxford, all at Harvard. They know. These folks know. Understand that. Especially these so-called highly educated folks. I read, there is a, I wish I could find it. I will read it for you. Henry Kissinger, I think he was like Secretary of State back in that day with like Nixon and them and all of that. He was one of them heathens that was in the United States government. He spoke about the traveling Jews of Western Africa. The government knows, man. These folks know who you are. Only people really don't know us is, yeah, everyday folk may not know. But the main person, the most important person who don't know who we are is us. It's time to awake, Jerusalem. It's time to wake up through the ideas of opening the eyes. It's time to open your eyes. You see what's going on around you. It's time to awake and put on the strength of thine arm. Put on the strength of Hamashiach. What strength is that? He told us what strength it is. The Old Testament ain't nothing but the New Testament. What is the strength of Hamashiach? Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers, the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of Elohim, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, the strength of Hamashiach, because Hamashiach had on the whole armor of Elohim, which will make it where you can withstand in the evil day. We in the evil day. You see what's happening. You see what's happening. Oh, this got to come to a head. All that fighting going on overseas, this election finna come up where America's gonna have to take a stand. Both of these presidential candidates is gonna have to take a stand on the side of these wars, and you're gonna have to take the one that's gonna win this election. Oh, it's all gonna come up. This ain't going nowhere, no time soon. How you gonna stand in this day when these governments mess around and get to crumbling? No matter what we do, you're gonna need the whole armor of Yah. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. You better be standing on it. Hey, yo, see, when you take the Shakespearean off, you can hear Shaul, who's from a child. First off, you better be standing on the truth. That's what he said. Your loins is your leg area, your hips. You better be standing on the truth first. Having the breastplate of righteousness. When you poke your chest out, it better represent the character of Yah, because that's how you show true righteousness. And your feet, the way you walk, better represent the gospel of peace. When people see you, you should represent shalom. Even if you a mighty man, like Daniel, I know you a mighty man. But I know when you walk in a place, though, people don't see that on you first. The first thing they see is the shalom that Yah to put up on you. Hallelujah. You somebody else, I believe, who fear Yah.
You got no choice, bro. No other choice.
Hey, yo, you somebody else, I believe. Because I know if you didn't fear Yah, you might be out here with your chopper or something. You be cool, man. Oh, man, look here. You somebody else, I believe. Above all, take the shield of faith. This is how you put on the strength of the arm. The strength of the arm, the work, is a Mashiach. What was his strength? He had on the whole armor of Yah. The shield of faith. Faith is what's going to protect you. Remember, the shield is how you play defense. Faith. As this world fall apart, no matter what we do, your shield is going to be based on faith. Wherewith you shall be able to quench all fiery darts of wickedness. And take what? The helmet of salvation. Doing what's right got to be on your mind, got to be on your head, got to be where you, how you're thinking. And the sword of the Ruach, which will cut, the sword of the Ruach will cut, which is the word of Elohim. That's how you're going to make it. That's how we're going to make it. Where did I stop at here? I don't even know where I was at. Where was I at? I was somewhere around here. Where was I at? I got thrown off jumping around. Where was I at? Made it past that and that. Nah, was I that far? Memphis and abolish. Oh,
is it hearken into something? Hearken into.
Right here. And on my arm shall you trust. Was this where I was at? I don't know. I need to miss something here. No, I was further down than that. I was verse 8, I believe. Awake. Oh, this is where I was at. My fault. Oh, Jerusalem, and put on the strength of thine arm. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 down. If you don't know what the strength of his arm is, you got to put on the full armor of Yah. Awake as in the early time as the ancient generation. Remember who you are, Jerusalem. It's time. Remember who you are. In the KJV, it added something. It says, art there not it that have cut off Rahab, right? Rahab is what? The proud. It's the strength of Yah. It's the arm of Yah that's going to cut off the proud. We read that up. He said, and when we read Psalm chapter 40 to start this, he said what? Blessed is the man who doesn't follow after the proud. The word here for Rahab just means proud. And wounded the dragon. That was the first prophecy of him. What was that prophecy? It said, the son of man will bruise the head of the serpent, the dragon, and the dragon will bruise his heel. Just like that. Art thou not it that dried up the sea, that dried the sea, the water, even the abundance of the deep, that made the depths of the sea a way of passage for the delivered and the redeemed? The arm who's coming back to judge is going to make a way in the sea. A second Exodus. We read earlier in Isaiah, I don't remember what chapter, seven highways in the sea. What sea? In the oceans. The Pacific, you're going to walk across it. The Atlantic, you're going to walk across it. The Indian and the Arctic Ocean, because you all over, you're going to walk across it. All rivers, you're going to walk across it. Oh, you're going to walk back across them. Who? The delivered and the redeemed. Those who are obedient to following after the character of the name. Those who have been awakened to obedience. Those who have been awakened to be puffed up but knowledge. And wilding with your own people, you better be careful. Remember, it's only ever been a remnant. We don't truly know what that number is. This is my opinion. Let me say that, because I don't want nobody to take this the wrong way. This is my opinion. But for me personally, I got to be better than just knowing I'm a descendant of a slave, the transatlantic slave trader, African American, and I'm from the tribe of Judah. I got to be better than that if I'm thinking of a remnant. I can't leave nothing to chance. Therefore, almost done here. Therefore, the redeemed of Yah shall return. You, the redeemed. Therefore, the redeemed of Yah shall return. It's a marker. The redeemed, the Ashkenazi Jew, claims that he's the tribe of Judah back in Jerusalem. Okay, we see what these scriptures saying, right? Let's see if they fit it. You're going to come with singing in the Zion. Did they come with singing in the Zion? You might could say that. You know, America and France and England and or the UK and Russia and all of these different spots threw a lot of money at them. Ariel, what's up? What's up?
That's
we are here reading.
That's
come here.
That's whiskers. Catch whiskers.
Come here. You might as well say shalom now. Say shalom. There you go. Look. Say shalom. Shabbat shalom. Can I finish reading?
It's cat's whiskers.
Go here with your mama now so I can finish reading. She got it.
Oh, it was cat's whiskers.
Oh, shut that door. Such is life. Hallelujah. They came with singing, possibly. I mean, why would you not? The world done paid you to go home, supposedly. But it's more. Everlasting joy. The word for everlasting is forever. Is it joy there now? Everlasting joy shall be upon their head. They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and mourning shall flee away. Is it sorrow and mourning now? Is it fear there now? That's a marker. They sorrowful now. Their Messiah that they waiting for. He ain't corrected all of this for them yet. But it say when you come into Zion, this is going to follow you. Where it's at? They've been there now for over 70 years. Where it's at? Verse 12, I am he that comfort you. Who art thou? That thou should be afraid of a man. Why are you afraid of a man? That shall die and then of the son of man which shall be made of grass. You ain't got to be feared of no man. Why? Because you Israel. You got Abba Yah. Verse 13, and forget the most, you've got so used to fearing man, you have forgot your maker, the one who made the covenant with Abraham on your behalf, which is why you've been spared, that have stretched forth the heavens and laid the foundations of the earth and has feared continually every day because of the fury of the oppressor. Who? Who fear every day over the fury of the oppressor? Do the Ashkenazi fear every day because of the fury of his oppressor? He is an oppressor. They tried to tell us October 7th, 1,200 supposed European Jews were killed on October 7th. Since then, they didn't kill 20,000 Palestinians, 10,000 kids. They sound like the oppressor to me. No, y'all said you're going to fear the fury of your oppressor as if he were ready to destroy. And where is the fury of the oppressor? Where is it? Where is it? No, them people over there staking claim to that land. The Arab and the Muslims say the covenant was theirs. That's their land. The Ashkenazi say that's their land. Y'all just told us, no, this is whose land is going to be. Him who fear, who has to fear continually every day the fury of his oppressor. And when I send him back, it's going to be gladness and joy. Mourning going to flee away. He ain't got to worry about no man. You know why them people over there got to worry about men? Because they both laying around waiting on America. America need to tell Israel that what they, who, how can you stand by and watch open genocide? I still yet to this day have seen any Arabs take off on TV and say, we ain't worried about nothing. We don't care about America. No government. Allah going to come over here and defend us. Y'all tell me. I ain't heard no Muslim go on TV and take off and say that. You know why? Because his faith is really fake. That's a lie. I ain't heard no Jew go on TV and say, Yahweh gonna defend us. We don't care if America don't feel what we doing in the rest of the world. Yahweh gonna come and defend us if they step away and not support. You ain't heard none of them say that. You know what they say? They talk big publicly and privately. They begging the government, like, please don't step away from us. Because if America step away, in Syria and Lebanon and Iran and Jordan, all of them will make war with Israel right now for what they're doing to the Muslims in Gaza. You don't hear neither side of that talking about what they God gonna say. You know what you hear us on this call saying? You know what you hear me saying? I ain't worried about none of that. You know why? Talking about what the oppressor has done to my people. You know why? Because I know I follow an Elohim who gonna come fight for me. You can't just play with me. Can't nobody just come play with you? No. Blessed is he who blesses you and cursed is he who cursed you. I believe that. Even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you should see no evil. I believe that. Even the people that sit in darkness have seen a great light. I believe that. Under the shadow of his wing will I protect him. I believe that. They put me on the news right now. I'm telling them, y'all on his way. The one who justified me is drawing near. Hallelujah. The captive exile hasteneth that he may be loosed and that he should not die in a pit, nor that his bread shall fail. Hold on. He don't get intense here. 17, okay. But I am the Most High Yah, thy Elohim, that divide the sea, whose waves roared, Yahuwah Sabaoth, which of hosts means Yahuwah, head of creation, head of armies, head of angels, head of everything, is my name. Remember that. Remember that. That's who fights for me. No, that's who fights for me. If all 35 million or so African Americans in this country, if we was all standing on that right there, could nobody right here do nothing with us? But we not. So that's why we still see our brothers and our sisters falling victim in the streets. That's why Cat Williams is making interviews talking about Negroes is really the ones holding Negroes back. That was the gist of what he was trying to say. You know why? Because they Elohim is Mammon. They Elohim is Jesus Christ. See, they waiting on that white man to come save them. So when they get around them white folks passing out them checks, that's Jesus Christ to them. We gonna do what he say. No, not me. No, and he don't fight for them. Black folks know Jesus Christ don't fight for him. We've been following him for 150 years, and the black condition in America is worse than it's ever been. We know that's a lie. Hey, if you think I'm lying, go outside your house if you live in the hood. If you don't live in the hood, drive to the nearest hood. Has Jesus saved our children? Because all our grandparents been asking him to. Has he? No. We on more drugs than ever and stronger drugs than ever. We kill each other at an all-time high. We rape each other at an all-time high. We sleep with each other, husbands and wives, at an all-time high. Jesus done left us, done led us astray. Everybody, granny been praying for him and grandfather. Where he at? No. Mm-mm. We know better now. See, we understand Proverbs now where it say he that turned away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayers is abomination. No, they can't teach us that we don't need to know the law. No. And then from that, we learn the character. And we start to be obedient from that. And then from that, now we pray in the name of Yahushua or Yeshua or Yahusha, however you pronounce it. As long as you represent the character, it don't matter how you pronouncing it. Because y'all told you, your tongue going to be changed. So he already told us, I ain't even going to hold against you that you ain't going to know nothing about speaking no language. I tell you, the Most High cover every base when it comes to this. He told you your time's going to be off. That's why you keep your Passovers all over. That's why you keep your Shabbats on all these days. I ain't going to hold that against you because I already told you 2,000 years ago, you ain't going to know nothing. You ain't going to know the language. You ain't going to know the time. You ain't going to know the heritage. None of that. But you know that I stand for loving kindness, though. You know that I stand for being decent and in order, though. You know that I stand for true righteousness, though. You know that I stand for mercy and forgiveness, though. You know that I stand for some decorum in the way you carry yourself. You can't represent me and you be talking all dismissives and flipping out your mouth. Really, that's being proud, insolent, arrogant. Arrogant in the way that you address things. That's really what that is. And the Israelites who I've seen from afar, mostly, to be honest with you, who do that, then I'll catch them in the same breath, say something ignorant. What you so arrogant for, like you got it all figured out, man? Slow down, man. Slow down. We ain't on that. This ain't the season for that. This ain't the season for that. No, we follow the Elohim that's fighting. You all do. Like I said, this call was started about people who didn't know nothing about this. And some of them, most of them, I honestly, that we've really had this run with, me and my wife, my family, has grown in their own way in Torah. They're all works in progress, just like myself. But hallelujah, I'm thankful for the fact that they've grown in their own way in Torah. And I want all you to know, because a few of you is on here, you serve an Elohim now that fight for you. Don't you forget that. Don't you forget that. And I have put my words in thy mouth, not my own, not your own. Like, think about that. We arrogant for words that we didn't even put in our own mouth. How that work? And I have covered thee in the shadow of my hand. My hand, my yo, my work. I done covered thee with the shadow of my son, your Messiah. That I may plant the heavens and lay the foundations of the earth. And say unto who? The church, the saints, to say unto Zion. It's time for you to wake up, Israel. You are my people. 17, it's time to wake up. That's the second time he said that. Israel, it's time to wake up. Stand up and do what? Be obedient. If you don't do nothing else, get obedient. Show some grace to your brother, your sister, your friends. Even if you got to rebuke somebody, do it with love and kindness and respect and compassion. No, y'all proud. You be talking crazy. You be talking crazy. Everybody swear they waiting for the wilderness. It's some people who couldn't stand to be in the wilderness. You know why? Because they used to talking crazy through Zoom and through the internet and through text message. And when you get in the wilderness, that crazy gonna be met with sternness. Everybody ready for the wilderness? Is everybody really ready for the wilderness? Have you ever really thought about what that's gonna be like? What is this gonna be? A bunch of Israelites in there throwing out scriptures and doctrines and being all over the place? No, that's gonna be met with sternness. See, it's easy to just do that through a text message and be all flippant at the lip. It's easy to just do that through IG. They call them keyboard warriors. It's easy to just do that on Twitter, on YouTube, or through Zoom. It's easy to do that. It's a lot harder to do that when we all standing in a circle. We were just all in Sukkot. You ain't catch none of that down there. You know why? And the people down there, I don't believe is on that anyway. But you know why you wasn't going to catch that down there? Because it's a lot harder to do that when we all standing in a circle. See, one thing about my generation and the older people from me that this young generation don't get, you could talk all reckless on social media because you may not never see that person. When we was growing up, you had to watch how you talked about somebody because it was inevitable. Y'all had to bump into each other because you couldn't just kick it online. You had to go outside. See, it's the same difference. All this hooting and hollering and the way we throw these scriptures around and being proud and being puffed up, it's easy to do that through this technology. It's a lot harder to do that when we all standing in each other's face. It's a lot harder to do that. Israel, it's time for you to wake up to obedience. It's time for you to stand up, Jerusalem, that has drunk at the hand of Yah, the cup of his fury. Yeah, you've been going through it. Is that the Ashkenazi? Is he going through it? When's the last time he went through it? Don't tell me he went through it in the Holocaust and that's over with, because scriptures say when I put them back in Zion, it's going to be everlasting peace. They over there at war, been at war. If you study the last 70, 75 years of them folks being over there claiming they the tribe of Yehuda in Jerusalem, they've been at war from the day they got there. Fought a war with Egypt, fought a war with Jordan. They've been at war. No, it ain't never been no peace there. So how do that align with scripture? Now, I know who the drunk of this fury, but thou hast drunk and drained the cup of calamity, the cup of wrath. Oh, I know who done did that. I know who did that. And there was none to comfort thee of all the children whom thou borest. Now, can't no man save you, but who? The Messiah. And there was none to take hold of thine hand, not even of all the children whom thou hast reared. You even got some Israelites who call themselves the Messiah. That's a Negro running around calling himself a king. King David, the king and shepherd. Negro, what? And then make an excuse to break all the law. Boy, you better be careful. I believe the only reason, Daniel, that joke ain't been rebuked is because the Negroes who he going back and forth with be out of. If he was doing that with somebody righteous, I believe we already been seeing a sign where he was in trouble. That's my biggest takeaway from that. He able to do that because the Negroes who he going back and forth with be out of order too. We finna see him. Wherefore those things that guard against thee, who shall sympathize with thee in thy grief? Who gonna sympathize with true Israel in his grief? Who sympathize with you? The whole, mind you, we know after World War II, the entire world sympathized with the Ashkenazi. Italy, Japan, Germany, everybody chipped in to help them establish a state, as they call it. Who sympathized? Y'all said, wait, wherefore these things are against thee. Who shall sympathize with thee in thy grief? Nobody. Who sympathizes with you? During World War II, while you was over there freeing them, it was descendants of slaves right in this country fighting in the war. Segregating units, got back in uniform, was called niggas. Went to jail, some of them died. I want to say Tulsa was behind that. It was a man in uniform did something. Man, that started a riot. They burnt the city down for Negroes. Who gonna sympathize with you? Nobody sympathized. And when you read the Bible, nobody has ever sympathized with Israel. Downfall and destruction, famine and the sword. That's what's gonna follow you. You on the bottom. Your people been destroyed. Your people always been hungry. You've been in survival mode for 400 years. And the sword don't follow, even with these wars on the planet. The sword don't follow nobody like it follow you. We just seen that. We see that every day. The sword don't follow nobody like it follow you. Who gonna comfort you? Now, sons are the perplexed ones. They lost. Why? They sleep at the top of every street. They on every corner as a half-boiled beet. They on every corner. Who? They are they that are full of the anger of Yah, caused to faint by the Most High. Who full of the anger of Yah on every corner? Who do that? Who do that? Hold on. We know how to look outside the awakening. We on them corners, pants sagging, selling dope, smacking women, blowing guns. You know how I look outside the awakening. Now go into the awakening. Who on every corner? Full of anger. Ain't inspiring and encouraging nobody. On the corner rebuking white folks. You a heathen. You Esau. The sister dressed half naked. You going to hell. Who we talking about? Who do that? Who is he talking about? Who do that? Therefore, here, with all that being said, Yah said, after all of that, I love how the scriptures do that. Yah go really hard on Israel, and he typically always is. But hold on. With all that being said, you who have been afflicted and drunken, but not with wine, thus saith the Most High Yah, thy Elohim, that plead the cause of his people. Behold, I have taken out of thine hand the cup of trembling. That's past. No, the time of these Gentiles is coming to an end. We see that. Turn the news on if you think I'm lying. It is calamity in every country. I just seen that the farmers in like Germany shut the highway down. They everywhere. It's hectic. This reckless world order that's been around here lying and stealing. No, I didn't take the cup out your hand. Even the dregs of the cup of my fury. Thou shalt no more drink it again. The cup of calamity. You ain't gonna drink it no more. I done moved that. With all that being said, I done took the cup out your hand. This is your chance to do what? Wake up to obedience. You might not even know that black folks is Israel. But you know, you know that honor and humility is right though. You ain't got to know you Israel to know that that's right. You ain't got to know you Israel to know that we need to treat each other better. We don't got to know that. You don't got to know that. You ain't got to know that that's wrong to sleep with your man, baby mama, or his wife, or whatever. You ain't got to know that. We didn't have to know it was wrong to sell dope to our own people and destroy our own community. You ain't got to know that. It's time to wake up to obedience. With all that being said, I'd have took the cup of wrath from him, but I will put into the hand of them that afflict thee. What's going on in the world? They got the cup of wrath. The cup of wrath is passing. You see it. It's hectic. There's war everywhere. Wars and rumors of wars everywhere. Which has said to thy soul, bow down that we may go over you. The people who had told you to lay down so we could step over you. I remember you didn't heard that story. You didn't heard that story. Bow down so that we could walk over you. And thou hast laid thy body as the ground and as the street to them that went over thee. Oh, that went over. No, that's over with. That's over with. I done took this cup, this war. I took my, now you still going through it because some of y'all, most of y'all, sadly, don't want to change. Whether knowing or unknowing. I done took this cup from you. Awake, O Jerusalem, because I didn't give you an opportunity here. Don't wake up and get all puffed up with no knowledge, acting like you somebody. I'm the one who put the instruction into you. I put the words in your mouth. I taught you everything you know when it come to me. Right? I done took the cup from you and gave you the opportunity to wake up to be obedient. Learn love and kindness. Learn some decorum. Learn how to be decent and in order. Learn true righteousness. Learn how to speak a good word to your folks. Learn how to be a real brother and a real sister, not just talk. Don't just be an Ankh entitled. Don't just be an Akoti entitled. Learn how to be a real Ankh and a real Akoti. Learn some compassion. Real talk. Humble yourself. Real talk. Y'all all might be right, but y'all all might be wrong. Keep that in the back of your mind. But if you don't do nothing, get the character of my name right. And you got a shot. You see the world. It's calamity. This cup done passed. You got a shot. Hallelujah. Any questions or comments anybody want to speak about anything before we go? Hallelujah. Anything anybody want to add before we get up out of here? It's always a pleasure to see you all in here as well. We made it to the end in decent time, too. Hallelujah. I've been trying to be decent and in order with the time. See, I'm learning. You can be decent in order with time. Hallelujah. It's a pleasure. I really mean that. It's an honor. Because y'all ain't my people. Don't ever forget that. You all are not my people. You all are the Most High Yah's people. And it's an honor for him to allow me to read Torah with his people on his Shabbat for his purpose. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oxpeed, you there? Shabbat shalom if you're there. I got a question. If you hear me. If not, Ak Daniel, are you there?
I'm here.
Can you pray us out, Aki?
I can.
Hallelujah.
Let's humble ourselves before the Most High. His throne, his greatness, his perfection, exalted be his name. We thank you, Almighty Yah, for this holy Shabbat, for this day of convocation, for this day of fellowship amongst your people, for us to be a light to all nations. We thank you, Abba Yah, for your gifts of Torah. We thank you for this teaching and this fellowship, and we pray that the Ruach HaKodesh will guide each and every one of us this day and every day forward. We pray for the full armor of Yah to be with us as we walk forward. And we have interactions with different people in different situations that we encounter. We pray that your Torah will be embedded in our DNA and that you will put us on autopilot, Abba Yah, that we will live and breathe in your character and in your nature. We thank you. We pray unto you in the name of your son, Yehoshua HaMashiach, who died, who was obedient to your will, the perfect example of Torah. And in his name, we thank you and we pray. Hallelujah and amen.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Amen.
Always a pleasure, family. Everybody have a blessed day. Shalom, shalom. Y'all got to see Ariel. Tiffany seen Ariel fro is fresh.
Shalom.
Yeah, I saw it.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom, family.
Shalom. Everybody have a beautiful day. Shalom, Ima, Kathy, both shalom. Of y'all.
Shalom. Shalom, have a good one, y'all.
Shabbat shalom, Mike and Ebony. Good to see y'all. Shalom, shalom.